heartbreaking global superstar. Shakira. Las Mujeres Ya No Lloran World Tour. Get tickets now at Shakira.com.
The views expressed in the following program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of Saga 960 AM or its management.
Well, I'm glad that you've joined me for In Focus with Annie J Koshy, where I look at people and their milestones, places where international changemakers are impacting our world, as well as events that bring our communities together. Now, before the break, I gave you a little bit of background on my next guest. Ask yourself this. Wouldn't you like to get past the things that have held you back from being your best self and just be that self? Dr. Travis Fox has been architecting lives, cultures, and stages for 30 years, holding doctorates in both psychology and clinical hypnotherapy. Travis has been named by Yahoo Finance as a top 20 entrepreneur for 2020, and even more recently, top 10 Instagram influencers by BuzzFeed. Travis has been on radio shows, podcasts, television programs across the US, across the world, really, and he's been on several high-profile shows, including XM Radio Saturday Mornings. Now, Travis has been on Sigurd Vettel's show, and like Sigurd, he has a burning desire to help others and impact their lives in a positive way. Now, from television programs like ABC's One to Live, the Nashville Network, and Resorts Network, to name a few, he's also appeared in the recent documentary film Beyond the Secret, The Awakening, which was released March 2020. This is a long-awaited sequel to The Secret, which has gone on actually right now to win over 12 awards, if I'm not mistaken, as well as How Thoughts Became Things, which was released April 2020. Coming from a world of movies and entertainment, today's guest is really going to leave you informed and entertained because his passion for life and being really permeates all he does. It's absolutely contagious. So sit back. I'm going to introduce to you and bring onto the show right now, Travis Fox. Welcome, Travis.
Thank you. Are you sure you're talking about me? I always ask that same question. They read my resume every year and I'm like, is that me? Really? Wow.
Huh. I thought I embellished that resume a little bit here and there.
I was like, wait a minute. We could add all the Emmys on there. We could add, the telly. I mean, we could add all this other stuff. And at the end of the day, who cares? I'm like, that's great. What does that have to do with how this is going to impact your listeners? I always kind of chuckle when they do that. I'm like, well, if that's the credibility it takes for someone to listen, great. I think that the message is usually more entertaining, but nonetheless, thank you for having me on the show and giving me a good moment to reflect and go, wow, it's been an interesting 50 years so far.
Yeah, you know what? I think, Travis, the impact of what you've done is beyond anything that could really be acknowledged in a paper form or when someone sort of gives you a recognition. Because really, your work is on an individual basis, and you work with individuals and you work with people because you really are interested in helping them be their optimal self. And I think that is really something that's worth discussing. Let's talk really about how you were able to redefine and refine really so that people are able to optimize themselves and get past some of those automatic processes and those negations that they have of themselves.
Man, I feel like you should be the doctor. I'm like, those are heady words. I'm like, you need to come down to my level, which is just duh. So thank you for that. Space. My answer to this, the self-help industry has been, and I'm kind of the black sheep. If you watch the film Beyond the Secret, I'm one of those guys that says, that sounds really cool that if you just think it, it'll fall out of the bloody sky. And that's not true. And I think that was what the impetus when I came on, because I co-produced that film as well as being on the front side of the camera. Which I hadn't been on both sides in a long time. I'd been behind the camera for about 4 years working on other projects. And I just said, look, I'm really tired of the industry just saying, hey, I can help you live a better life. Oh, can you? How? And see, I'm a how-to guy. So my journey started 30 years ago when I went for my first quote-unquote self-transformational experience, because back then, and you know the story because we've had these conversations before, but your audience doesn't know, and you can go look that up over on our website, btu360.com. You can see the full story, but the full story was, I was born and bred by my father to be a PGA Tour professional golfer, and yet on the opposite side with my mother, who was a model and actress, to be in modeling and acting. I'd started, runway modeling when I was 9 years old. which, you know, back then was super not cool because you couldn't be a model and also be, an athlete at the same time. You had to be one or the other because that's the cool kids clique. And I was like, well, but I am. And, but my father really wanted me to be that. And when that all came crashing down, at 19, I went, where I thought self-help would take me. And what I really got clear on was that self-help and self-transformation are two radically different things. And that became the impetus and quest that I've been on for the last 30 years with the Architects of Being Academy, is to teach people how. And not from a I know everything. I mean, I'm not one of those guys. In fact, I'm a huge critic of the self-help industry. I have been for a long time because I find it incredulous that we take people to these workshops. We have them have these great cathartic experiences, which are really just, endorphin squirts in their brain, but it doesn't psychologically, emotionally, and most importantly at the being level, create change. I believe change comes from the being level. It doesn't come from the mind. The mind is the process of the being. And of course, more importantly, the expression. And so everything you see about mindset training, I spent 20 years in mindset training. I give massive credit to, and I got to fulfill a childhood dream earlier in 2020 this year. Dr. Dennis Whaley was really kind of my first read into this world with the psychology of winning. I mean, this guy was a giant in my world. And to be on film with him now and be able to work with him and be considered by him, one of the best speakers on the thing, which is still to this day, I'm like, Dennis, are you sure did you have something in your coffee, brother? You're talking about me, man? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, you're still the man. I mean, you're still the guy. And so to have that come, some 40 years later, to be able to be in a film with him and co-create with him and teach alongside him was amazing. But I give him that credit because he was the first person that said, hey, let's look at the structure of mind. And then, advance roughly, it was about 7 years later because I started reading that when I was 13. Around 19, when my world came crashing down, my golf career came just to a screeching halt because this wonderful thing happened called life.
Right.
And life said, well, guess what, Travis? Here's a couple things. You are clearly asleep. So we're going to just smack you upside the head and we're going to wake you up. And I find that a lot of people have had that cathartic experience. Now, right. It represents itself in many ways. Mine happened to be that I decided, subconsciously at an architectural level to become a father. Which right. I was completely ill-prepared for and might still be.
That happened at 19. I think my slap on the forehead came at 46. So I'm glad that...
I didn't say I haven't been slapped multiple times since then. I just think that's the one that knocked me clean off, out of my shoes and said, so this whole golf thing you're doing, right. That's for your dad. That has nothing to do with your architecture, your heart's journey. And you need to snap out of this mindset thing that you're doing, this self-hypnotic journey that you're programming yourself on top of the programming that I'd received from my parents of who I was, what I was supposed to be, and what success was, and what was acceptable of success, and how was I going to realize my potential, and all these things that we all as people have heard pretty much since elementary school. And we take it these kind of this innocuous statements. We don't really think that they mean a whole lot, but they do. And they show up in the weirdest and strangest of ways, and they're repetitive. And then, that famous saying that says, why do I do the things I don't do? And how come I don't do the things that I want to do? That if you know that saying shows up, and then you start asking the question. Well, I was one of those guys that said, I don't want to just ask the question. I want to know the blueprint. I want to know exactly what the steps are. Now, that doesn't mean that every step you take necessarily applies to you. But if you have a blueprint from how to get from A to Z, then along the way, there's this beautiful experience called your architect or your heart will show up and go, okay, let's fill in that blank here. Let's understand that awareness there. Let's understand what that trauma and fracture really is. And most importantly, understanding that you are still a being. I don't care how you define being. I'm not educated enough in anybody on this planet to say you're a being because of X religion or X philosophy or X theology. I'm just simply saying, let's agree. There's a part of you that came into this human experience and it's going to leave your human experience. So we call that the being, you call it whatever you want, right? But that simplicity says that there is something much larger or bigger than us going on here, and that our body mind, which we all know cognitively, which is the hilarious joke. We know cognitively this journey we call humanity is going to end. And yet we have no control over that. So we do everything we can to distract ourselves. And that becomes the journey of going, wait a minute, am I really Travis Fox? Or is that just the name my parents gave my spacesuit, my humanity, so we can identify me among the other 7.8 other billion human beings on the planet? But is that really who Travis Fox is? And that became the cathartic moment of, wait a minute, who am I without golf? How do I define myself? Right. Am I a failure now because I choose to change my life and go, yeah, I like golf and I'm very good at it. And I've coached at the PGA Tour level. I've coached 4 major winners. I've been on golf channel. I've done all those things, but that still wasn't a good enough for my father because it was my father's image in my head of what success was, what potential realized was, what the definition of the investment in me as a child versus the investment in me as just his son. And there's a big difference in those two.
That's quite interesting that you say that, because I want to stop for just a minute and let our audience know that in conversation right now is Dr. Travis Fox, and he is speaking really about the difference between living and being, and really what is the difference. Travis is, one is living, and I think I've done it myself in my own journey, in which I was towing the expectations and the demands and what I thought other people wanted me to do, whether it was in my head or whether in their head. And they were projecting that on me. And when I stopped my own decision to go ahead and be a certain way, I started to come into my full light of who I was as a person. And that was an awakening.
Yeah, can I play on that for a little bit?
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Okay, cool. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm so frustrated with this whole addiction that we create in the self-help industry that says, you've got to become enlightened. You've got to come into your full light, using your quote. It is the biggest load of crap out there. You're already enlightened, people. You came in enlightened. You're going to leave enlightened. What's happened is you have dulled yourself through experiences called compression, suppression, and oppression, stuffing down what you really want to say. And I'm not talking about being aggressive or angry, just in your bona fide truth of yourself. You've stuffed down the things you really want to explore because someone might judge you and think you're perverted or a wacko or completely off your rocker. Yet, ironically, most people are thinking the exact same thing, but we're so afraid of the social deconstruction of what if I'm outside the cool kids clique? Well, let me save you a lot of time. You were never in it because there isn't one. That's the biggest dang illusion we created in high school. Go all the way back to the West Side Story, the film, if I can quote my filmology world. I'm like, wait a minute. There is no such thing as the cool kids, not cool kids. And you remember the movie in the 80s, you know, the outsiders with, you know.
Absolutely.
Oh. Like, you got the greasers and you got the cool kids. I'm like, no, you don't. You just got an expression. Because guess what? I'm both. I was a cool kid. I was a dork. I was, you know, I was the kid that was like, yes, I was, you know, a starting quarterback. But by the time I was a senior in high school, I decided to be cheer commissioner. Why not? I wanted to
chair commissioner for what?
No, cheer as in cheerleader. I went from the guy that they were cheering for, the quarterback, because I was starting quarterback as a freshman. And then I went to the guy that went, I'll cheer for him. Because guess what? I don't like football. It sucks. I got two broken ribs and went, that's not a good golf career choice. It's hard to turn, you know, and play football and golf. They're two very diabolically opposing sports.
You know, when my son played football, Travis, I have to say, I would come in, I would pick him up at school. And the first thing I would do is show me your hands, show me your feet. You got all your toes, all your head. On one piece. Okay, we can go home. I think I saw the inside of emergency rooms, every hospital here for something or another, every, you know, month or every 2 months, it was there.
Yeah. And I was that guy that said, well, wait a minute. Somewhere along the line, I was astute enough by my own stupidity. And I use that in very clarity because I wouldn't say Travis Fox came up with it, but my architect, my own heart, my own being said, newsflash kid. Yeah. What's up? You're here to explore and experience everything because you're leaving soon. Now, I know you think 100 years is a long time, but it's not. So let's snap out of this a little illusion that you have time, which I think is the biggest self-hypnotic perpetuated myth that most humans have been, you know, really kind of ingested upon, is that you have time to figure it out. No, you don't. I lost four of my friends in high school that never graduated. They're dead. They're gone. They never made it. And so we hold this illusion that, well, when I get to my 40s or my 50s, that's when I'll, you know, I've made enough money. Oh, shut up. You may never make it there. Stop. That is the illusion in and of itself. And mediocrity is the death of extraordinary. And extraordinary doesn't mean you have to go out and become the next Steve Jobs or you need to create the next Amazon. No, extraordinary means you experienced everything you wanted to experience, small, medium, large, however you choose to define it. But you had the courage and the compassion to move away from who they told you you were supposed to be and what the definition of success was. And the definition of wholeness, by the way, which is a whole nother illusion in the world. You need to go find your soulmate. You find your other half, which means you only have a person. That makes no freaking sense. If you're only half a person, cut off both your arms and your legs on your right side of your body and walk around. Then you'll find out, guess what? You're a whole person.
We've been in conversation with Dr. Travis Foss, and as you can hear, he is animated, he is passionate, and that is the real reason why I have brought him on this show, because he talks about things that are not just superficial. He talks about things that he absolutely fervently believes in and practices, and has actually gone on to impact so many lives with it, several hundreds of stages. We're going to come back in conversation because I'm not done with him yet. So you've been tuned in to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. And we're going to take a short break, and we will be back right after these messages.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy, where I am in conversation with Dr. Travis Fox. He's an actor, a producer, director, author, keynote speaker, inspirational individual, and a friend of mine. Travis is a Hollywood veteran. He's appeared on a variety of programs, including ABC's One Life to Live, Talk Soup, the Nashville Network, Resorts Networks, and the Golf Channel. Dr. Fox was the creative engine behind the Beat the Boogeyman, the first golf show in public broadcasting history, and also have been featured on the Dew Sweepers, as well as on Speaking of Golf, radio programs on the Sirius XM's PGA Tour Network. I want to ask you, welcome back, Travis. I want to ask you really what your creative process is, because you have a grounding based on the fact that your mom is also in the entertainment industry, or was in the entertainment industry. You've had that from childhood. You've been on stages from the age of 9, first modeling, but you went on to be in front of the camera as well as behind the camera. I'm an individual like that as well. I work both in front and behind the camera. There is a creative process that you go through. Let's talk through that right now, because someone who's listening right now who has the desire to become a producer or a director, or who has that desire to be in front of the camera, there are so many words of wisdom that you could share. What do you suggest?
Run. Run fast. It's not what it looks like, family. What right. You see is the finished product is not even remotely close to the truth. And if I may, at the risk of being self-effacing or self-promoting, excuse me, it's beat the bogeyman, like golf.
Oh,
for those of you golfers out
like,
there.
Like, oh.
Yeah, like bogey, like plus one.
Right.
And I designed that, and it ties into the creative process, because when I first did that infomercial, we were the first psychological golf infomercial in the world that ever came out and said, hey, look, golf is mental. So that's great. This club makes you hit it 400 freaking yards. Well, if that was true, we'd never buy another club. So that's a constant illusion of manufacturing. That's part of their journey. And that's great. But game is mental. Well, life is too, from a certain point of view. But life is really about dropping one level below that. But golf in and of itself says it's got to be a mental game. And so we approach it from the perspective. People are like, wait a minute, why'd you call it bogeyman? That's negative. That's over par. And I said, well, let me ask you this very simple question. For all you golfers out there, let's just put this in perspective. I always said, hey, do you know how to make a birdie? Every golfer's like, yep, I know how to make a birdie. No problem. That's my goal, is make birdies. I said, great. Do you know how to stop making bogeys? And that's exactly why we named it How to Beat the Bogeyman. And Bogeyman was a personified experience, which goes back to my golf career of, hey, there's these guy running around in my head that comes out of freaking nowhere. I mean, literally nowhere. I mean, there's a whole character he designed around the golf ball, those bogeyman golf balls, that literally says, you know, standing on the first tee, I'm like, yeah, this is a par 5. I can get there in 2. And then right before you swing, it says, don't hit it in the water. You're like, what? Hey, where'd that come from? And that really, now fast forwarding 30 years later, you come into the film How Thoughts Become Things. Because it cracks me up about people all the time, especially the mindset training people. And no disrespect to my fellow coaches out there in the world and trainers, but they go, I'm going to teach you mindset. I'm like, great. That has nothing to do with what's driving the belief structure. So I can give you all the positive affirmations you want. I can have you focus on these things. But guess what? At the end of the day, there's this random little thing called the bogeyman that runs around in your head that just throws thoughts. Here's proof. All of your listeners right now, ask yourself this question. Annie and I are having this conversation. You're tuning in. You're paying attention. And yet I guarantee you, you've wandered off and think things about, I've got to go get the kids, or what's groceries I've got to go get, or what's the next call, or hey, I'm just wondering why that color is blue. Things show up all the time in the random nature of the conscious mind. And yet we think we're thinking.
Record-breaking global superstar. Shakira. Las Mujeres Ya No Lloran World Tour. Get tickets now at shakira.com.
Thinking them. We're not. We're sorting through them. And then you start to get to identify, well, where does that sorting come from? And the creative process for me became twofold. One, I've been on stages my whole life. And for me, I'm that weird reverse person, you know, where I would be on tour for 6 months at a time, seeing, you know, do 225 performances a year. And, you know, the average was about 3,000 people per experience. And sometimes I do two or three a day. And that became a really great experience, but except for one thing. I started to realize, well, wait a minute. I can only present what I can present based on the time frame that I have. So I started looking at, well, how do I tell a story? You see, because what really I think is the legacy, and this is what the architects community, actually, especially in the mastery classes, we teach you how to become metaphoric story structuring so that you understand how to tell a story. And I'm not telling like telling a kid a bedtime story, although that's where it starts, but truly understand how do you speak at a conscious level, a subconscious level, most importantly, at the heart or the architectural level simultaneously. See, because once you understand how the rules of the mind work, you can tell a story that creates this beautiful thing called emotional compulsion. And emotional compulsion means we're endeared to the characters. We're endeared to the hero's journey of the arc. We're endeared to move to the next chapter. We're endeared to ask ourselves a question that we know we've been avoiding, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so the creative process for me became, how come everything in the self-help industry sucks? It's boring. It's the same thing. Hey, Annie, you know, you're this being and you can live this great life. All you have to do is think it and it magically appears. But what about the 98% of people who go, well, I did that and it didn't show up. So am I not in the cool kids clique? Does that mean I suck? Does it mean I'm not the right one? But that's exactly what it's designed to create. And it creates this addiction that says, you've got to go to the next thing. You've got to go to the next workshop. You got to buy the next book. You got to keep feeding this mind. Well, guess what? That's like feeding a black hole, because feeding your mind has nothing to do with your truth. Your mind is just a big old storage bin. And great, if you want to store it with a bunch of stuff, awesome. I'm all for storing it with things that you want to learn about. But how about the experiences? Because it's not the things that are in your mind that you relate to other people. It's the experiences, the emotion that drives it. We're emotional creatures. And yet, this is the question, and you and I've talked about this before off the show. You know, ask yourself this question, listener. When did you trade in dreaming for hoping?
Right.
And when did you trade in being for doing? And then most importantly, when did you trade in a life of exception, a life just extraordinary, for mediocrity, commonly passing through, which represents an EKG thing called flatlining? You just passed through, man. Your heart's dead. When did that happen? And that's the whole point of architecture, is a step-by-step blueprint, not to go find out who you are. That's insane. It's ludicrous. It's to remember who you are before they sank their teeth in you and said, you need to be this and you need to be that. And if you're not, you're a failure and you've never lived up to your potential and mom and dad are going to be mad at you and your culture is going to think you're not in alignment. All bogus, man. It's all bogus, because there's only one noble truth on the planet, family. There's only one. None of us are getting off this planet alive. Now that gets the real question. Have you really lived the life you want to live? And now most people say no. And then that asks the next question. And there's a two parts to it. And so one, here it is, listeners. If you only had 30 days left to live, would you be doing anything you're doing in your life right now? And if any part of your answer is no, and any aspect, any category you want to dump it in, then you owe it to yourself to stop. Because the only person you're messing over is yourself. Because at the end of the day, we all take the great journey by ourselves. We do. I know that sounds morbid, but I love picking on life coaches, because they go, well, I'm a life coach. I'm like, great. How do you coach about something you're still in? That makes no sense. People go, what do you do, Travis? I'm like, well, if you really want to be fun about it, I'm a death coach. I'm like, oh, do you help people grieve? No, I help people face the fact that they're going to die. And until they face that ultimate fear and release themselves, they haven't really lived yet. It's a reverse model. Everything we've been taught is still putting people to sleep, which is hilarious, because I have a whole doctorate in clinical hypnotherapy. I've done it. I've been there, done it, bought the season pass. And I'm like, wait a minute, the joke's on me. My mentor and master was such a brilliant teacher. He's like, Travis, I taught you all this, not so that you can go out and think you're hypnotizing people, you knucklehead. I taught you that so you could teach people how they're hypnotizing themselves. They're already asleep, brother. And I went,
right.
Wow, that's like Obi-Wan kind of stuff, man. I was like, wow, they didn't teach that in school.
Now, I actually had a moment where when you said something, for me, that slap on the forehead that happened, or the side of the face, or wherever it was that I saw myself at that point, was when I sat up and I went, wow, I have less life left to live than I have lived already. And that was a stark reminder that I have to do what I want to do. It really made me sit up. And that was the catalyst, really, for me to say, stop. I cannot do it. And I actually made a phone call to my family to say, you know, I did this. This is something you wanted me to do. I did it. I was the perfect this. I was a perfect that. I was did that. Did all of that. That's done. Let me just be. Let me be myself.
Yeah, I think that's a valid point. You know, and you know, I turned 50 in November of 2020. So I'm
on the. Wow, I could never tell that from your voice.
Well, thank you. Well, turning 50 doesn't mean that I'm 50, right? I think that's the, I know. Ivor says you got to grow up. I'm like, why?
No,
I don't think so. That makes no sense, right? I don't know many happy adults. I know a lot of happy kids, but I don't know any many happy adults. So I'm kind of like Benjamin Button. I've lived my life in reverse. I was responsible. I was Dr. Fox. Thought I knew something. Had the perfect life. Was, you know, married to the beautiful blonde. The kids. I had the big traveling RVs and multiple houses, and I had all this stuff. But I didn't have the truth. I didn't have it because I was too busy being Dr. Fox of what I thought I was supposed to look like. And I was supposed to have all the answers. And to your quote, which I think is excellent, and your listeners really should really hearken to that, being perfect sucks. It's a full-time job. It's exhausting. It's emotionally overwhelming. And more often than not, is fraught with negative thought processing that comes from your own. I'm not living up to. And I'm like, living up to what? You're only going to be, I happen to be 6'2", now maybe 6'1" from, you know, from compression of gravity, but okay, I'm 6'1". How can I live up any higher? Do I get stilts? Do I climb a ladder? What does that mean? It is such a misnomer. And English language is such a rudimentary tool of communication. And yet we give it such in-depth interpretation as opposed to going, stop, wait a minute, stop trying to be, just be. And then, of course, that scares us to death, puns intended, because if we're just being, we're not doing, we're not accomplishing, we're not creating the ladder of success, we're not getting the cars. And hey, man, I've had them all. I've had money, lost money, had money, lost money, had money. And yes, having money is better than not, but let's cut the, you know, the butter here, boys and girls. At the end of the day, it's not going to buy you another breath. It's not going to have you have another experience. It's not going to create any more intimate connection than you currently have right now. All it's going to do is afford you the opportunity to connect more if you're willing. And most of us aren't willing. We think we are willing. And then we play the same game over and over again. And then we have the same parties at cocktail parties, our same conversations at cocktail parties, and wonder why we never have any interesting conversations.
Because I cannot stand. Okay, so you hit the nail on the head in terms of that. I have a severe allergy to these networking or cocktail type parties where you go, I actually go in and I try to sneak out. And I'm one of those people, for your 6'2", I'm 5'3". So just above your waist, I would say, if we were to ever meet.
I don't know about that, but okay.
And I was saying, I'm one of those personalities to walk into a room and I have a 9-foot personality, but I cannot leave. I cannot sneak out of an event. So the minute I start to try and sneak out, someone goes, oh, Annie, by the way, I want to introduce you to, and I get sucked back in. And in my head, I'm going, I want to leave. There is no one here having any conversation at any depth that is beyond, hi, how are you? Great. And that's it. It's superficial mishmash of nothing.
Yeah, I agree. I stopped doing network events about 5 years ago. My staff does them because they are trained very well and they go ask questions that they're penetrating. Because I'm not seeking to be different and shocking, and you know, like the shock jocks and all. That's not my agenda. My agenda is, look, if you're not willing, I didn't say I had to be perfect with it because I don't know what perfect is, but if you're not willing to connect, what's the point? What's the point?
We're going to take a short break right now. When we come back, we're going to talk about your upcoming event, a live event that's happening at the beginning of 2020. You're in tune to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy here on Saga 960. We're going to come back right after this break.
Stream us live at saga960am.ca.
Welcome back to In Focus with Annie J. Koshy. We've been in conversation with Dr. Travis Fox about architecting your life. Now, reaching beyond the common uses of conscious and unconscious models, Travis has perfected a step-by-step program designed for those who are ready to transform their lives and wake up from the hypnosis of the day-to-day boredom. And I would say that we go into this rut. We have a schedule. We have an agenda. We just continue function in that. And that's all we are really doing is just functioning. I would like to bring Travis back. I want to talk to you about an upcoming event that you have got at the beginning of January called Jump. Let's talk about what Jump is.
Sure. Well, Jump Ties In, you know, is a program I wrote actually 20 years ago, and it was it's obviously evolved over the last 20 years and the people that have gone through it. But Jump is based on the simple concept that everything in our life starts with a jump. Got to jump on a phone call, got to jump in the car, got to jump in the shower, you know, go jump into this meeting. We do all these things to jump, but we don't jump into ourselves. That's why it's called the jump in training, jump into you. And the reason we don't jump in is because and this is something I talk about a lot, and you know, you've heard me talk about this before, is it's not that we're scared of the unknown. We're scared of the known, because right. You know deep down inside what the heck is going on. But the problem is we don't have a step-by-step blueprint on how to unwind it without it consuming us, without me getting caught in it. I'm going back to replaying the loop and over again. And I need a gestalt model. And I need to go have a thing about my mom and dad and a Freudian model. And those are all great. They were great giants. But people, we're past that now. We have learned over the centuries of what actually works in human development psychology. And so the jump is the 7-day journey. It's actually 21, but I haven't done it in 2 years live. And my board asked me to do it live this year because of obviously what we've all gone through in 2020, which has been anything
right
but dull.
Right?
Anything but dull.
2019, and we go right into 2021. Let's just move this out. But you know what? 2020 has been fantastic for myself. It's been a great year, right?
Yeah,
you're right.
Yeah, our academy for us has had over an 825% growth in the last 7 months. And that is because there's two parts. Our mission statement and our entire agenda is to change the educational system back into a learning system. So ours isn't just watch a video and hope to gosh, you get it. It's actually interactive. You have live master architects that teach and gone through it, who have gone through the exact same journey you are. We have data tracking. We have all the workbooks. Everything's done so that we know the data is getting in you both at the logical level, meaning conscious, but most importantly, you're understanding the blueprint of how to change subconsciously. And well, mostly at the being level, at the heart level, and unwind those traumas and fractures without having to go through this years and years of stuff, right? Because we come from a very different philosophy. Our philosophy is very simple, family. We don't have any answers for you, but we have really good questions and a step-by-step blueprint that's been developed over 30 years, time-tested and trained with literally hundreds of thousands of people who have gone through this journey to go, wait a minute, I'm the architect of my life. I'm like, yep. You always were. You just got self-hypnotized, hypnotize yourself for a while to go, I'm not. And I'm like, but you are, but that's still you creating, just creating the knot. So the jump is the first 7 days where you jump right in. And this isn't if I could just give you one thing, Annie, that'll make you feel up. No, we're going to throw your butt right in the deep end of the pool from day one, bang. So we're going to show you exactly how it works. You're going to have the exercises that you can see in your own life, no matter where you are on the planet in real time, how your conscious mind is observing, how your subconscious mind is projecting, what's the emotional driver that's driving you, and how to change it step by step. But you're doing the work. You have an entire global community inside our academy that supports you. There is no such thing as judgment, because who are we to judge? We're on the same freaking journey. We've just been doing it for a while. That's all. It doesn't mean we're better. And anybody who says that they've got it all figured out is lying to you or selling you something, because they're still on the bloody planet. So when they leave the planet, well, that's different. We all get, you know, quote unquote, fully enlightened. In the meantime, what if we said, hey, you go, we go. We constantly go from experience. So that 7 days is me teaching the first 7 of the 21-day jump live, and you get to experience it. It's $99 for USD. You get to experience literally an hour of me every single day. And of course, if you've enjoyed this interview, imagine an hour of me just going bananas, teaching what I love to teach. But I come from a teaching not of I know, as opposed to we go. This is the next step. Observe what you observe within your journey. Unwind it from the conscious perspective. See how the belief structure was created. Know the emotional driver that created. Where was the trauma and fracture where you created this personality part that keeps you from being who you really are? And more importantly, keeps you from experiencing what you really want. And then come into this beautiful thing we call the fear to freedom movement. And when you do that, you start to recognize that most of our life is based on a fear mechanism. Even though we don't want to, we're still reptilian in our brain, and we're still from that space of fear. But fear is not the fear we talk about eating by dinosaurs. It's about being judged, not good enough. How come I keep doing the same things over and over again? How come I think these thoughts and I can't stop? I lay awake at night and I look at the ceiling fan and going, it's going to end. No, it's not, because you're in the one creating the loop. And when you understand the dynamics of, wait a minute, I'm the architect of my life. You are. You always have been. You are, even when you think you're not, think being the operative word. There's this beautiful thing that happens. You get to drop the fear. It's not I need to let go. You don't need to let go. Just literally change and choose. And we'll show you the difference between a decision and a choice. There are a very big distinction between the two. And as you start to move through the academy, you can take these massive journeys from how to heal and for how to develop the relationships. These are all master teachers. Everything that's on our academy is exclusive to our academy. They are not programs you can find all over the world. They are designed for you to come, take the journey, get the knowledge, experience it, ingest it into your DNA. Because once it's in your DNA, it's just you, man. You don't have to think about it. You don't have to get up every day and write your daily affirmations and put it on your vision board and do all these things. And they're great, but it's a lot of work.
It is. And I think that's why for a lot of people, they find it very frustrating, Travis, that they plug into all of these, like you said, the self-help world. And a lot of these gurus or masters come back and say, do this and create a vision board. Honestly, I've never, ever in my life created a vision board. I never will.
I can't see it. I mean, I wear glasses. I can't see the dang thing.
Well, my creative side goes, well, I don't want to just do it like this. It's going to have to be like this, and it's got to have the bells and whistles. I'm going to make an entire thing. It's going to actually be a stage show. And like, that's where my head goes. And it's like, okay, at the end of the day, it's too much work. And so I don't do it. So for those,
and, John Asraf's a good friend of mine who developed, kind of the vision board concept in the early 1990s. And we were in the film together, Beyond the Secret, as well as How Thoughts Become Things Together. And it's not a disrespect to John at all, but I find that most people don't understand what John's actually saying. So here's the challenge. When I go and I put, let's say, I want to have this car, and it's going to be that car, it's going to look that way. What you're telling the universe is it can only look that way. Well, what if it doesn't show up that way? What if the universe says, hey, Annie, I hate to be rude and just kind of interrupt your little, I think you've got it all figured out thing. What if there's something better? What if it's another car? What if a friend loans you the car and you have to buy it? What if a friend says, you know what, I don't even like this car, I'll give it to you, because you say it has to be a certain way. You lock yourself into an ideology. And then when it doesn't happen, guess what you do? You beat yourself up mentally for being a failure, for not being good enough, not being the right guy, not understanding it, not right girl, not having the right partnership, the right business, not the right knowledge. You come up with all this stuff to beat the snot out of yourself of not being good enough again, which, by the way, I hate to break it to you, family, that's a program too that you learned a long time ago and you've been playing it out. Isn't it time you unwind that and go, this or something better?
Where can anyone find you, Travis, in real life? If they want to reach out and find out more about the programs that you offer, if you're listening right now and you want to clear your confusion, you want to design what you desire, you want to, find out how to create that emotional shield or tap into the law of abundance. All of these components are different things that you speak about and teach on. And I'm sure our listeners here today are going to want to find out how they can actually get in touch with you and find out more information. Where can they find that?
Well, in fake life, they can come find me on the internet at btu360, which is biggerthanus360.com, our online learning academy there. We have two major components. One, you can take individual courses a la carte, as I've said, they're all exclusive to what we do, from becoming certified masterful practitioners to healing your life to parenting skills to literally understanding what archetype you are. Or you can go to the main thrust, which is what we call the backbone, which is JUMP, Architects in Training and Architect in Mastery. And then you can come back as a certified master architect and actually teach at the academy and scale a lifestyle. If you don't know what your mission is, don't know what your passion is, but you just love to help and you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, you can come and be an academy member and get paid to do your stuff.
Well, there you have it. I hope you are ready to architect your life or just jumpstart your year, whatever it is you'd like to be your optimal self. So information for all of my guests today will be available, or just reach out to me at info@saga960am.ca, attention Annie or the Ninja. If you've missed out on any of my live shows, you can tune in on Tuesdays for a repeat show from 9 to 10 p.m. You can also tune into our website at www.saga960am.ca, where there will be a podcast of this and other great shows. Stay safe. This is Annie Koshy signing out.
No radio? No problem. Stream us live on saga960am.ca.
Record-breaking global superstar. Shakira. Las mujeres ya no lloran world tour. Get tickets now at shakira.com.